joking with Troy before the service that just like when we started Obadiah, we started in Genesis. You know, why start in Obadiah when you're going to preach Obadiah? Just go right to Genesis, which is always very helpful. But there is a method to, I don't know if it's madness or not, but to my, well, let's just call it what it is. It's madness. There is a method because my goal is for us to not see Scripture as disparate parts that just exist in old country buffet, the Bible, and like I'm just going to scoot over here and take a scoop of this, but to see how they all really do hold together and make that beautiful meal that we have that we can feast on regularly. And I love that image of the tapestry, too, that we use from now on, every now and then with an illustration that a tapestry looks beautiful on the one side, but you turn it over in the back and you just see all the loose ends. And when we see that this Scripture truly does hold together, I think that we will be able to grow in our confidence in the power of the Word, but obviously the God who has given us the Word. And this morning, our time in the Word is going to be centered. We'll spend some time in Acts 19 to set the stage for how the gospel went to Colossae, however you want to pronounce it, to the Colossians. That'll get us back to Bible language that we can pronounce better. How the gospel got to Colossians. I wanted to set the stage for building how the Lord used people to bring the gospel far away from where Paul was meeting resistance. And in fact, using that resistance to be the catalyst for spreading the gospel of Jesus Christ, which I think is outstanding for us because we live in a world where the gospel meets resistance, don't we? Yeah. That's like the most obvious thing I could ever say at this point. That when we meet resistance, we don't have to look at them as obstacles to the gospel because God is powerful and mighty and His word will never return void. And so we can have confidence in when we see even rejection that God is still using it as we are faithful to bring the word to our families and to our neighbors and to our coworkers and to the bagger of your groceries and to the bank teller if you don't bank on your phone. I mean, all these wonderful opportunities we have to bring the gospel that when we meet resistance or hesitation or even obstacles that God is still powerful, mighty, and active and using. I wanted to begin with a little bit of background in terms of Colossae, the town, and it sat about 125 miles west from the western coast. So if you want to get the map up real quick, this has been squished because I built it on a different platform or a different size. So if this looks odd to you, it's because it's been smushed. But Paul was what Sharon just read for us. Paul was stuck in Ephesus, and so that was where he was reasoning in the synagogue for 3 months, and then two additional years in the hall of Tyrannus. And what we see is Colossae. I picked a map without Colossae on it because I thought that'd be helpful. but when you look at the maps of Paul's missionary journeys, it's not on it. And so actually it's not on it, and I think that is helpful because it lets us know that Paul never made it to the Colossians. And Paul actually, the ministry of Paul was present in the Colossian area, but it wasn't through him directly. And what we'll see as we look through Scripture in a moment, we'll see that there was a man named Epaphras that went from Colossae, which would have been right about here, back towards Ephesus when he heard that Paul was there. But I want us to get an idea of the setting of where the Colossian church was at as well as how it started. And Paul's missionary journey is denoted by this blue dotted line. And you can see as he was going around, the section that Sharon just read for us would have been right here. Acts 19 is Paul in Ephesus before he then moves on, kind of sneaks back through the area again. He meets with the Ephesian elders later, right down here in Miletus before he takes off, and we'll actually read from that as well. So just to kind of give you a visual about where we are, this is Jerusalem. Micah's not in here, is he? Oh, you are here, yeah. Micah's going to be in this area pretty soon. He's going to be going to the Holy Land, so that's pretty exciting. So to give you an idea of where we're at, this is modern-day Turkey. So if you think about what we've been hearing about with some of the earthquakes, that is where everything is taking place. So you can actually leave that up for a little bit so that you can be distracted by it and have a picture to look at while we're talking. But Colossae, the city, sat about 125 miles from the western coast. It was also near the cities of Laodicea and Hierapolis in what's called the Lycus Valley. This was an area that was great for shepherds and for having herds of sheep. And the Colossians area was known for being able to dye its wool red. So they got very lucrative advancements in their economy because of that ability. But about 2 or 3 years before Paul the gospel made it to Colossians, there was an earthquake there, and really from that point on, the city, which had about a 500-600 year history, started to go down. Their glory days were really behind them when Paul's gospel, when the gospel of Jesus Christ made it to Colossae. In fact, we didn't even find the remains of this city until the mid-1800s, and a lot of it still remains unexcavated. But there are remains of what, there's two buildings that are potential sites for this Hall of Tyrannus that's mentioned in Ephesus, I should say. So there's great archaeological evidence that is pretty neat to find from this region. But the Colossians were sitting kind of inland and not on the coast. They didn't have a major trade route going through them. And like I said, at the time that the gospel made it there, their glory days were ultimately behind them. But that doesn't mean that the gospel wasn't going to have its amazing effect. So the question then becomes, when did they first hear the gospel? When did the Colossian church first get evidence of the gospel? And this begins, if we think about the genealogy of that church, it begins here with Paul in Ephesus. And that's why I love this scene, because we look at this scene and we see roadblock after roadblock. We see hesitation, we see obstacles, we have evil being spoken of the way, which is Christianity as it was referred to by some, the way, because of very likely John 14:6, Jesus says, "I am the way, the truth, and the life." So Christianity, one of its nicknames was the way, because they followed Jesus. And that's basically the beginning of this church. Paul is in Ephesus on that third missionary journey. Apollos had gone on to Corinth, and Paul passed through the inland country and came to Ephesus. And there he finds some disciples. So we're in Ephesus on the coast, Paul is anyways. And he finds some disciples of Christ. He had already been there before, you can see on that map there. And he meets with some disciples and asks them. He wants to know, what do they believe? So he asks them, "Did you receive the Holy Spirit when you believed?" Notice the question, first of all, because sometimes this text can be twisted to push towards baptismal regeneration, or you don't get the Holy Spirit until you're baptized. This text can get twisted that way. But Paul doesn't say that here with this question in verse 2. He says, "Did you receive the Holy Spirit when you what?"
Believed.
When you believed. That's when you're given the gift of the Holy Spirit. It's when you believe. It's not another act. It's not a second giving. It's not a second gift of God to give to you. No, it's when you believe. So are you believing rightly is ultimately what Paul's asking them. And they say, to the answer honestly, which I love that, they say, "No, we didn't even know there was a Holy Spirit." I'd probably argue that in much of Christendom today, people don't even know there's a Holy Spirit. He's the most neglected member of the Trinity in many circles, or he's the most over-exalted member of the Trinity in many circles. And we have to hold the Holy Spirit where he rightly belongs, which, as we saw through that upper room discourse, is to bring glory to God, to bring glory to God through pointing people to Jesus Christ and using the word of Christ to point people to Christ. And we know that Christ then gives glory to God. So they didn't even know there was a Holy Spirit, and so they're confused about that. So then Paul asks them, he said, "Well, then what were you baptized?" And they said, "Into John's baptism." And isn't it great that now Acts even now links up with the Gospel of John? Because in the Gospel of John, we read about John the Baptist, and John the Baptist was considered a forerunner. He was to prepare the way for the gospel to come forth, and what better way to prepare the gospel than to teach people about repentance? And turning from your sins and turning from a life of ungodliness or unbelief or wrong belief and turning to the true God in Jesus Christ. And so they were on their way. They had heard about repentance. And so their idea of baptism, as it was understood wrongly or maybe incompletely as they were taught, was that that was just it. We were baptized to symbolize repentance. And of course, Paul's going to correct them on that. Paul said to them, "John baptized with the baptism of repentance, telling the people to then believe in the one who was to come after him, that is Jesus," meaning John wasn't even making a big deal about himself. It's like, I am merely a big, giant, shining arrow, brightly shining, that there's one coming, and his name is Jesus. And then when Jesus did come onto the scene, we see John humbly, even almost, not almost, trying to deny Jesus, even baptize him. Like, why should I baptize you? I'm not even fit to untie your sandals, let alone wash the feet. Even John would hear these disciples in Ephesus and go, no, 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 if he still had a head at this point. You know, he's beheaded. Even John would be like, no, don't make much of me. My whole ministry was to point to Jesus, was to prepare the way that Jesus is coming. It's about Christ and having faith in him. The repentance that I preached and was baptizing for was to point to the fact that then after baptism or after repentance, you believe. Repent and believe. The two wings of that fly is to the grace of God in Jesus Christ. Jesus was the one to whom John was pointing, and upon hearing this, upon hearing the complete giving of the gospel, simple as it is, but complete, upon hearing this, they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. In contrast to John, it's not a human in whom we are baptized only, it's the Lord God, the human, the man God, Jesus Christ. And when Paul laid his hands upon them, the Holy Spirit came on them, and they began speaking in tongues. And in the book of Acts, we know that the tongues are known languages, in particular at Pentecost, as people were hearing dozens of languages spoken by people that had never been trained. Can you imagine that? I love analyzing that scene in Acts 2 when after Pentecost and the fire of the Holy Spirit fell upon them. Because is the miracle in the speaking of the language or the hearing of the gospel in their own language? And there's some room for debate there. But regardless, they were hearing the gospel in their known language. These people were flooding to Jerusalem at that time. Many languages were present in the hearing, and God made it possible that at that moment the gospel of Jesus Christ was going to go forth. And people were going to hear, be convicted of their sins, repent, believe, and they were baptized. 5,000 of them, right? Oh, what a day. And then how that spread out from Jerusalem, and we're now actually standing in one of the ripples of that amazing event as those ripples went forth on the world. Now you've got in Ephesus people being saved, and you have the same ministry coming forth as people are now speaking in tongues and they're hearing, because again, Ephesus on the coast would have been a pretty metropolitan area. You would have many languages going there, and people are going to hear the gospel come forth. Interestingly enough, side note, Luke gives us here in verse 7 of Acts 19, there were about 12 men in all. It doesn't say there was 800,000 men of all. It's not the number that denotes God's power. It's the truth of the gospel going forth. You can be a lone voice and see people saved. And I love the fact that Luke gives us this detail, because you and I, or maybe just me, we can be drawn to numbers, right? Like, oh, there was this many people at this conference or whatever, or this many people were saved. And we have entire, sometimes, denominations that report how many baptisms that they've performed. It's like, tell me about the lives changed. I'll get excited about one person turning from their sin and saying no to alcoholism and all of a sudden saying yes to life in Christ and how their family has been changed. I'll get excited about that. But you say, we baptized 87,000 people. Okay, awesome, that's great. But tell me about the lives changed and what Jesus has done. And I think Luke's saying to us, there's 12. Good number too, very biblical number. There's 12 men in all. I've told you guys this before, but my joke is when I go to pastor conferences, not a lot of people, but sometimes people will ask how big your church is. And some of you are new here, so this will be good. Other of you can already tell what I'm going to say. But they'll ask, they'll say, oh, so where do you pastor? I'm like, oh, in Delton. They're like, where? I'm like, exactly. Well, how big's your church? And so I'm like, man, 6,000, 8,000? And they're like, what? Delta? What's the name of the church again? Why haven't we heard of you? I'm like, well, square feet. No, how big's the God we serve? How are lives being changed? How are people trusting in God? How are they growing in their admiration of the God who has saved them? How are they, are they being discipled to trust Jesus with everything in their lives? Are they growing in their faith? That's what I get excited about. Oh, don't get me wrong. I'd love for more people to come, but the people that are here want us to grow deeper in our love and our admiration and our holiness for the God that we serve. And you've got Paul. I mean, just we've got this amazing thing. There's people speaking in tongues and prophesying, and there's 12 men in all. I love that little note. And then even just with this small little ripple, small in terms of human terms, verse 8, and he, Paul, enters the synagogue, and for 3 months he speaks boldly, reasoning and persuading them about the kingdom of God. He's saying, you guys are standing at the doorstep of the kingdom of God. Now, look at what all of those things were pointing towards. Look at your Passover lamb. Look at all the sacrifices. Look at the priests. Look at the prophets. Look at the temple itself. Look at the Holy of Holies and see that this is pointing towards Jesus and trust in him. Repent and trust in him. Have life in him everlasting. You're there. You're at the door. I want to kick you through it. It's the first time I've kicked in the pulpit, but I pulled something. They're there. He wants them to be saved. And he's speaking boldly for 3 months. Verse 9, but when some became stubborn and continued in unbelief. That's ministry. Speaking evil of the way before the congregation. So now it's not just we don't believe you, but we don't want them to believe you either. And not just an unbelief, we're going to say evil things about the way, which is obviously blaspheming Jesus Christ. And Paul at this point just decides he can't further cast his pearls before swine, and he withdraws from them. And takes the disciples with him, and then goes to the hall of Tyrannus. If anybody wants to ask you where dinosaurs are in the Bible, this is not a spot. He was a known, very prominent Roman citizen that paid for halls and libraries to be constructed in Ephesus. Tyrannus would be. We know this from inscriptions that they have found. And so there was a hall that he had developed, and for philosophies to be shared. And so you would have Aristotelian philosophers and all these different people would come, and they would debate each other about why their philosophy was superior than the others. And these debates would happen early in the morning till about 11 a.m., what we would call 11 a.m. our time, and then from about 4 p.m. on to the evening, these debates would happen. You would have scholarly debates, academic debates, you'd have philosophical debates, and now you would have religious debates. But you want to know what tradition tells us was Paul's time, because this typically when they gave, especially Christians during this hall time, about 11 a.m. to 4 p.m., the hottest hours of the day. So they give Paul, very likely, the hottest hours of the day to come into this area of debate. And we know Paul is an excellent rhetorical arguer, debater. And for 2 years, he goes and debates and displays and argues for the merits of faith in Jesus Christ. He takes himself out of the entirely religious context of the synagogues, because he's been rejected there. But for 3 months he had an audience, and you know people were saved. And he takes his argument to the hall of Tyrannus, to the academics, to the philosophers. I would argue that that technique has been used in our day as well, to our dismay. The academics, the philosophers, have taken over many of our institutions of higher learning and are pushing people away from faith in God, in Jesus Christ, by their logic and reason. But this tells us that the battle's not over. We already know the war is going to be won, but the little battles aren't over, and that we can have a voice in the public square. That so often you'll hear that you can have your faith just as long as you practice it at home. Right? Keep your faith at home. Don't bring it out into the public square. To that I say, you don't have a faith if you're okay with that. You have a hobby. You have books you collect and maybe read and things that you believe and that sort of thing. But if your faith does not follow you and accompany you and actually lead you into the public square, then you don't have a faith. Because you have a God who's in charge of everything, who is over all. And he was right there with Paul as he's making these arguments for 2 years in the Hall of Tyrannus. And people were coming from miles around. And that's why I like Pentecost, Acts 2. You have people coming to Jerusalem, to this one location, and God using that amazing event to then send people out. And now in Ephesus, someone sent out. Now you've got another mini Pentecost, you could say, where God has sent Paul to this area, and he's having an amazing impact with a dozen people. And people are now going to flock to Paul. For 2 years, he's reasoning and explaining the faith in this hall, which is normally used for worldly debates. And people are going to start flooding to this area to hear about what's going on with Paul. He continues for 2 years so that how many of the residents, now of course, probably not every resident, but all the residents of Asia heard the word of the Lord. both Jews and Gentiles. If I was in Paul's sandals at that moment, like when you're in the synagogue and you're being rejected and they're speaking evil about not only the faith that you have, but the God that you serve, and you walk out of there and you go, you know what, I'm done here. If I was in Paul's sandals, I'd have been a little bit disappointed. Like, man, I want my countrymen, I want my fellow Jewish brothers and sisters to trust in Jesus Christ. And I'm sure maybe he even had a moment like that. But what did he do? Did he give up? Did he stop? He kept going, and he goes right into the public square, and for 2 years he has an opportunity to spread the gospel. And that whole region of Asia, I mean, we can pretty much just say, boop. And all from little Ephesus. Little tiny Ephesus, which got its start because of Jerusalem. These tiny little things where people come and then they're sent, and then you see the actual impact, the effect of God sending people and these explosions happening. The same thing here in Ephesus. A dozen men, Paul, preaching 2 years. And you've got the entire region of Asia now hearing the gospel of Jesus Christ in the face of what was surely an obstacle, a roadblock, a closed door. And God opens wide those closed doors. This is exciting for me because sometimes we can look at timing and we can look at what, you know, where are we seeing things happening, and Lord, what are you doing here? And then we read these stories where for 2 years I can't even imagine the debates, and then how many times if put myself in Paul's shoes or sandals, I would have been banging my head against the wall, like, I've already explained this to you, like, last month, what are you talking about? And he just keeps going and he shares the gospel of Jesus Christ. It's almost as if he believes that eternity matters. It's almost as if he believes that people apart from Jesus Christ will die and experience an eternity in hell as the just and right punishment for their sins. And he hates to see that happen without a chance to repent and to be an instrument of God's glory going forth as people get to hear the good news of Jesus Christ. Everywhere, not just in the synagogues, not just in the living rooms and the house churches, which honestly probably Colossae started as, but even in the Hall of Tyrannus, even in the Harvard, the U of M, yes, Tom, even Michigan State. There might even be unsaved people there. Or Delton Public Schools. Thornapple Kellogg Public Schools, Wayland Public Schools. If we have impact in those areas, we should be known as Christians. You should be able to bring those ideas forth without fear of repercussions, and we know that is a real concern these days. Paul spends 2 years there reasoning. All of Asia, many people from Asia are coming, and then we know all of Asia hears because those people go back. They're sent. They don't go to Ephesus just to have an experience and stay there and then wander away. No, they go to Ephesus. They're saved by God. He sends them back to their areas, and then they have gospel impact where they're from. In Ephesians 20, if you go forward just one chapter, Acts 20. Ephesians 20, it just got longer. Acts 20. We're going to read what Paul, how he summarized his time in Ephesus. He's gone up and now he's returned to Miletus, as we saw on the map. And he calls for the Ephesian elders to come to see him. I think that's great. So not only was the disciples in Ephesus schooled in sound doctrine and belief about Jesus Christ, but now a church is established. He's got elders there. There are elders that are going to share and preach and teach the good news of Jesus Christ. And he calls them to see him down in Miletus. In verse 17 of Acts 20, we read, "Now from Miletus he sent to Ephesus and called the elders of the church to come to him. And when they came to him, he said to them, 'You yourselves know how I lived among you the whole time from the first day I set foot in Asia, serving the Lord with all humility and with tears and with trials that happened to me through the plots of the Jews.'" We read about that, right, in the synagogue? They rejected him. They spoke evil of the way. Paul didn't take that lightly. It's with tears and trials. He experienced that. Verse 20, "How I did not shrink from declaring to you anything that was profitable in teaching you in public and from house to house, testifying both to the Jews and to the Greeks of repentance towards God and of faith in our Lord Jesus Christ. That message is not reserved for this room on Sundays. That message is not reserved for your quiet time in the morning with the Lord there only. You bring that wherever you go. That's how the gospel advances. God uses saved people to save people. Paul's testifying both to the Jews and to the Greeks in the synagogue at the Hall of Tyrannus that there's repentance towards God and there's faith towards God and there's faith in our Lord Jesus Christ. And now, verse 22, behold, I'm going to Jerusalem, constrained by the Spirit, not knowing what will happen to me there, except that the Holy Spirit testifies to me in every city that imprisonment and affliction awaits me. Lucky Paul, right? And again, you and I, or maybe just me, would hear that nudging, that leading of the Holy Spirit that tells him, you're going to be shackled soon. And you would go, defeat. Roadblock. Obstacle. And through the book of Colossians, we read that neither one of those things are true. But God uses even Paul's imprisonment to shape Jesus' church in many cities, and not just many cities, but many lives individually. There's a danger in you and I talking about situations like this because we think and we see these things in grand scale, don't we? Like we look and we say, all right, Jerusalem, thousands of people. We get lost in the fact that of those thousands, those are made up of individuals, that individual lives and families were changed. We read that, you know, all of a sudden he goes up to Ephesus and there's a dozen men that change the world around there and that people end up coming, and we lose sight of the fact that there are people changed. And that's the danger of running into measuring God by numbers. How many people are saved or how many people are in your church? Now, I want to know how deeper are you going with Jesus? And there's a danger when we start to think about things at a higher level or read about these things at a higher level for us in our fallen, sinful minds to go, big is better or big is awesome or big is the only thing that counts. And I love the fact that the Colossian church points us to individuals, that lives are changed. One such man that was changed is the man Epaphras. And so much like Obadiah being challenging to find, you can turn to Philemon when you find it. It should sit right before the book of Hebrews. One page. And while you're turning there, I'll give us a little background in terms of Philemon. Philemon was a man of Colossae. He was a member of the Colossian church, but who likely had a house church. The church met in his house very likely is what we can see from the very opening of the letter in verse 2. The church in your house. There was a group of people that met in his house. But Philemon was a man who had bondservants. He had slaves. He had those who were indebted to him. One such slave was a man by the name of Onesimus. So again, if you're looking for Bible names for your kids, Philemon, Onesimus, that'd be good for you. Onesimus was one of Philemon's slaves, and Onesimus decides to run away to Rome. He escapes to Rome, but while in Rome, either planned or not, he meets with Paul. And what happens when you meet with Paul is Paul doesn't spend a whole lot of time when he was in Rome saying, man, have you guys checked out their Caesar salad? And you got to get to the coast. The coast is beautiful. Oh, the waves come in. The sunsets are awesome. No, when you went and saw Paul, it was, can I tell you about Jesus? Onesimus is a runaway servant slave of Philemon, and he runs away, and he runs into Paul, which I think is pretty amazing. And Paul does what Paul does, which he tells people about Jesus Christ. Verse 8 of Philemon, accordingly, though I am bold enough in Christ to command you to do what is required, yet for love's sake I prefer to appeal to you. I, Paul, an old man, and now a prisoner also for Christ Jesus. It's basically saying I'm a slave to Christ Jesus just as Onesimus is your slave, your servant, the one who's indebted to you. He's working off a debt. Verse 10, I appeal to you for my child Onesimus, whose father I became in my imprisonment. Speaking of spiritual terms. Onesimus gets the great God opportunity to meet Paul, who's going to tell him about Jesus, and now Onesimus has repented and trusted in Jesus Christ. He's now a Christian. He's now of the way. Verse 11, formerly he was useless to you, but now he is indeed useful to you and me. He was a runaway servant. He was a runaway slave. He's useless, and now he's sending him back with Paul's very kind heart, verse 12. I would have been glad to keep him with me. I love that. Like, yeah, I really kind of wanted to keep him, but he belongs with you. In order that he might serve me on your behalf during my imprisonment for the gospel, but I prefer to do nothing without your consent. In order that your goodness might not be by compulsion, but by your own accord. Paul has the authority to command Philemon to take Onesimus back and to do so mercifully. Philemon is a man who has come to know Paul through a ministry, but we're not quite sure of the connection yet, at least as far as we've read this morning. But Paul has some authority over him, and he's commanding him to take back in love and in kindness his runaway slave, Onesimus, who very likely saw Rome as a place to escape. Hustle, bustle, thousands of people, big environments, it's easy to get lost and become one of a number. Verse 15, for this perhaps is why he was parted from you for a while, that you might have him back forever. He's a brother in Christ now, Philemon. Verse 16, no longer as a bondservant, but more than a bondservant, as a beloved brother, especially to me, but how much more to you, both in the flesh and in the Lord. So again, put yourselves in Philemon's sandals. You got somebody who's indebted to you, and rather than pay off their debt as they are required to do by law, they run. And in that moment, you're probably ticked, aren't you? Like, there goes my ability to be paid back the debt. Gone. He's in Rome. I'll never see him again. But God. Onesimus very likely hears that Paul's in prison there, has heard of Paul because Philemon is a Christian. Philemon obviously has heard of the gospel through the ministry of Paul in Ephesus. By way of timing, Paul would have been in Ephesus originally right around 52 to 54. And what we're reading now would have been taking place about 7 or 8 years later. Paul was imprisoned in Rome likely in 62, 63, maybe even as early as 61. So this is about 7 or 8 years after the church in Colossae has been formed. And all of a sudden, what does God use? He uses this terrible situation where Philemon's ability to get paid back the debt he has owed has run away from him. But what does God do? He has him run into Paul, and Paul says, tells him about Jesus Christ. And isn't it interesting that God would use somebody who is a prisoner, who's in chains, physically, very likely, obviously could have visitors. We learn from the end of the book of Acts, he was even paying for his own imprisonment. How awesome was that deal for the government? It's like, Paul, you're going to prison and you're paying us for it. So God takes a runaway slave and brings him to a slave of Christ. And I can guarantee you that Paul explained to him how great of a master the Lord Jesus Christ is. And how wonderful it is to be a bondservant to Jesus Christ. That Paul could be afflicted in chains, bound in what is likely now his second or third imprisonment. But he knows that the gospel is never bound. It's never in chains. Onesimus hears about the good news of Jesus Christ, that repentance is available, that he can turn from his sins and he can trust in Jesus Christ, the one that he probably heard Philemon's household trust in. And then Paul says, you should go back, and I'm sending you back with a letter telling you, Philemon, to take you back and to love you as a brother. Can you imagine that? You go back to the man you have run from, because you're stealing from him ultimately, and Paul says, I'm sending you back as his brother. That's transformation. That's what the gospel does. That's a change of heart. That's the result of revival. Hearts changed and people, their entire lives look differently now. They look outward and they see through a gospel lens of ways that they can show reconciliation and love and mercy and kindness and point people to Jesus Christ. I wonder if Onesimus is probably like, man, I'm carrying, I've got Paul. Paul on my side here. Of course, Philemon's going to welcome me back. Verse 17, so if you consider me your partner, receive him, Philemon, receive him as you would receive me. Receive Onesimus, your runaway slave, like you would receive me. If he has wronged you at all or owes you anything, charge that to my account. Where do you think Paul learned that concept? Thank you, Elaine. Jesus Christ looks to God the Father and says, as much as he or she has wronged you, charge my account. Paul lives this out. Charge my account. Verse 19, I, Paul, write this with my own hand. I will repay it, to say nothing of your owing me, even your own self. Like even your eternity is through the gospel that I brought you. Yes, brother, I want some benefit from you in the Lord. Refresh my heart in Christ. Confident of your obedience, I write to you knowing that you will do even more than I say. That's how you negotiate. At the same time, prepare a guest room for me, for I am hoping that through your prayers I will be graciously given to you. Pastor, what in the world does this have to do with Colossians? Look at verse 23. Epaphras, my fellow prisoner in Christ Jesus, sends greetings to you. You and I, through our time here in the Word, we talk about Paul, we talk about John, all these men and women from the Bible we talk about because we want to point to Jesus, because that's what they do. But if I asked you before this morning who Epaphras was or what role he played in the gospel of the New Testament, could you have answered me? I know I probably couldn't have before the study. I'd have been like, all right, I've heard the name. Somewhere in the New Testament, maybe the letters of Paul. And this is why I think this is so cool, because you and I know about the Colossian church. You and I know about Philemon because of this man, Epaphras. Epaphras was the one who was in Ephesus that heard Paul preaching when he was there, reasoning in the halls of Tyrannus. Epaphras was the one that came back and brought the gospel. In Colossians, we'll read this in just a second. He brought the gospel to that city and to Hierapolis and to Laodicea. He came back charged up from that time in Ephesus. It wasn't just to go and have an experience, hang out in Ephesus and talk about how amazing it is. No, he was changed, and he came back and he continued to change and to change the world around him. And all of it by the power of the gospel of Jesus Christ. By sharing the good news, by being word-focused, by pointing people to the way, the truth, and the life, Jesus Christ. That's what the gospel does to our lives. It changes cities, it builds and establishes churches, it changes communities, it changes neighborhoods, but it starts with changing hearts. And that ministry of Epaphras, being changed and won by Jesus Christ, the gospel of Jesus Christ, as Paul was arguing for it for 2 years and 3 months in Ephesus, maybe even upwards of three years. As Paul was arguing it, at some point, Epaphras was there and hears and is convicted by the Holy Spirit to repent of his sins, to turn and to trust Jesus Christ. And we think that's pretty cool on a grand scale, because it is. Colossians, Laodicea, Hierapolis are changed. But I get excited when I read Philemon. Because Philemon knows Epaphras. Paul greets Philemon for Epaphras. My fellow prisoner in Christ Jesus sends greetings to you, Philemon. Because we can read about cities, and we can read about churches, and we can read about big bodies of Christ. We can read about 5,000 baptisms. We can read about all of these amazing things. But what gets my fire going for the gospel of Jesus Christ is when you read Philemon, and you read that, holy smokes, look at what God is doing through just the words of fallen human men and women, and the lives changed by that. That Paul could say, you know what, Philemon, receive Onesimus. I know you're a Christian, you're a brother in the Lord, and guess what? Now so is Onesimus. Oh, and by the way, the man you heard about Jesus Christ from Epaphras, he says hi. Not only does he say hi, guess what, Philemon? Free Philemon, who I want you to take back in love and mercy, this runaway, indebted servant. He's now in chains. He's my fellow prisoner. Because a life submitted to Christ, here I am, Lord. Send me. Send me. Send me to the halls of Tyrannus. Send me to the campuses. Send me into the halls of government. Change people's hearts and get them involved so that policies can follow what Christ has for us. Change people's hearts so that when they go away to college, if they're going away to the den of thieves and to a furnace of lies, send them with the power of Jesus Christ. And know that even the power of Jesus Christ and the gospel of Jesus Christ can go forth in those dark and dismal areas and have an impact. Because lives can be changed, because a runaway servant who had nothing but freedom on his mind. Get me away from Philemon. I don't want to be indebted anymore. I hear Rome's a pretty awesome place for decadents. I'm going to go there. And what is it happens when he runs into Rome, a place where he could do anything he wants in complete anonymity? God finds him and says, "You're mine. Meet Paul. He's going to tell you about Jesus." And Onesimus says, "Yeah, I need to go back to Philemon, but he's not going to treat me well." And Paul says, "I got this." Wait, no, I don't. God has this. Why? Because somebody went and heard the good news of Jesus Christ. 8-9 years prior to Ephesus, makes the trip 125 miles. If you hike like me, that'd take like 8 years. Paul would have been gone. I would have missed it. Onesimus would have been partying in Rome. Somebody took the time to go and hear about the gospel, and then not just hear, but to bring it with them wherever they go. That's what we see the gospel doing, changing lives and being willing to say, you know what, Epaphras, we know by his name, he was a Gentile. He was not a Jewish man. And he says, I'm willing to even go to prison. I mean, to be honest with you, be chained up with Paul, that'd be pretty cool. I'd probably reach a new level of conviction of sin. I'd reach new levels of seeking holiness and wanting to be more like Christ in my life, because Paul says, imitate me as I imitate Christ. Everything Paul did was pointing back to Jesus Christ, and Epaphras caught that and brought that vision back to Colossae. So if you want, please turn in your Bibles to Colossians, and I promise you we're nearing a close. Colossians 1, verse 3. We always thank God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, when we pray for you. He's writing to the church, the vast church, the brothers and sisters, the saints and the faithful in Colossae. Colossae. Since we heard of your faith, verse 4, in Christ Jesus and of the love that you have for all the saints, because of the hope laid up for you in heaven. So it's not a fruitless love. It's not a Valentine's Day, willy-nilly love. It's a hope that's laid up. It's a love based upon the hope laid up for you in heaven, which is Jesus Christ. Of this you have heard before in the word of the truth, that's the power of the gospel, verse 6, which has come to you, as indeed in the whole world it is bearing fruit and increasing, as it also does among you, since the day you heard it and understood the grace of God in Jesus Christ, just as you learned it from Epaphras, our beloved fellow servant. It's the power of one changed life. One. Can I do? I can't speak well. I don't have a gift of using logic and reason. Well, good, because the gospel is simple. We've all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Meaning you're talking to fellow sinners when you share the good news of Jesus Christ. You're not high and mighty. You're not exalted above all. Repent. Oh, you're dirty, wretched. Okay, use those words carefully with whoever you choose your audience. You're a sinner in need of salvation. You've all have sinned. Use the mirror of the law if you have to. Have you ever told a lie? Use the Sermon on the Mount if you have to explode and expand the law for the thought life and the intentions and how we're all in need of the gospel. And go and share it with one other person this week. Just one, in your way, with your words, with your experience, with your gifts and talents. Maybe it's a friend you take out to coffee. Maybe it's somebody that you're friends with on social media and you share with them the good news of Jesus Christ. Maybe it's a loved one that you can share your testimony with, that they've seen, they can look and go, okay, yeah, that starts to make sense. And maybe you'll be rejected, like Paul was in the synagogue, in the Hall of Tyrannus. And so you know what you do the next week? Do it again. Share the good news. Is your life changed by Jesus Christ? Has he given you a hope laid out for you in heaven because of his mercy and his kindness of going to the cross and laying down his life for you? To say, whatever they owe you, Father, put it on my account. Not just that, Father, but call them your son and your daughter. They're a co-heir of grace with me. I'm their friend, Jesus says, pointing to you if you're saved. Go and share that. Because lives can be changed. I hope you know that personally. And maybe that's where this starts for you. Maybe now it gets personal. And you go, you know what? I don't know if I've repented and trusted in my Lord. Maybe that's where it starts for you. And that flame, whew, look out. But go and share and tell the good news. Because the only reason we can read about Colossians, the only reason we know about Philemon and Onesimus, is because of Epaphras. And the only reason why we know about Epaphras is because of Paul. And the only reason why we know about Paul in that situation is because he was in the Hall of Tyrannus. And the only reason why he was in the Hall of Tyrannus was because he was rejected in the synagogue. And the only reason why he was rejected in the synagogue was because he was brave enough to open his mouth to be rejected. Obstacle, roadblock, bang your head against the wall left and right, but God uses it all. So don't get discouraged. Live and share your faith wherever you go, in all avenues of life. Because that's how far the love of Jesus Christ has permeated in our lives. It's not fenced off. I don't fence off social media. I don't fence off my friends, my family. I'll be a Christian on Sunday. Well, you're not one. We're Christians 24/7. We walk and share Christ wherever we go because he overcame the biggest obstacle of all, death, and defeated it. And I love that Sharon earlier this morning referenced us to the fact that we have a God who has defeated death, and soon, in a matter of weeks, we'll be celebrating his resurrection because he is victorious. Walk in his victory as you go and share the gospel of his love, his kindness, his forgiveness, his holiness, his mercy, and his grace. Let's pray.